oak tree in the meadow clearing, and we were paying attention to the giant quartz crystal that is sitting in the center of this beautiful earth mandala altar underneath this giant oak tree here. And we are settling now under the tree, so you can make yourself comfortable here in your imagination and pull up a cushion, make yourself some tea, bring a notebook or a pencil if you'd like to take notes. And we are going to, today our intention is, what we're going to do is receive a very special transmission from Dan D. Lyon of Return to Nature, about plant ritual and the set and setting in plant ritual.
Hello and welcome. Thank you all for being part of this and to be together under this beautiful oak tree. And I invite you all in this meditative state to just take a moment and look within your heart and find that a flower resides in your heart, or a plant, any sort of ally that you resonate with, perhaps a plant that has healed you in the past. And to allow yourself to just really breathe deeply into the center of your heart, where this flower, this plant, is a guide and a protector. And we come here like plants together to grow. And we allow ourselves to harmonize this wonderful collectivity of all these different wild plants together as they harmonize their chemistry and their vibrations together. So what I would like to share with you all today is a little bit about work with plants and hopefully some things that maybe not everyone's considered in work with plants, and hopefully some techniques and ideas and ways to symbiotize with the living consciousness we can call Gaia, the consciousness of the Earth, in a way that really creates a feedback loop to nature. Many people know that nature is speaking with us. Gaian consciousness is speaking with humans. And it is very important on the planet at this time that we also learn some of the subtle arts and languages to let nature, Gaia, the Earth, know that we are hearing the message, that we are trying our best to receive this message and trying our best to bring forth these teachings in a way that's applicable, where we change our lives, and hopefully that reflects to the outer world, to the human family. So what I want to remind you all of first is that we often think we've transcended our cultural identity. And what I find is by exploring these cultural limitations that we often find certain things that maybe are still residing in ourselves. One of these is that we are above plants. The idea that we as spirits are somehow more alive or more conscious or more sentient than plants. And I just want to remind everyone that the plants actually are incredibly intelligent, incredibly alive, and since they cannot walk around, they've developed many, many methods of communication, which perhaps previously in our cultural upbringing and our cultural education, we've considered not to be language. What the scientists are now coming to realize and have to face is that obviously what most of us know is that language is not just small mouth noises. Language is not just what I'm doing. Language is art, language is expression, language is movement, language is pheromones, language is smell, language is looks, language is so much deeper than perhaps the idea of who here speaks through mouth noises. So what we find is that the plants, being our ancestors, who have been here for millions and millions of years, actually has been communicating through the whole ecosystem, through creating chemicals, through chemistry. And these communication signals are being tracked by scientists, and people are starting to realize that this whole chemical messaging system is a language in itself, and it's actually quite a mystical language, because we all know how it feels to consume coffee or consume chocolate or consume cannabis or eat a salad versus eat something maybe not as healthful for our bodies. Everything is changing and altering our consciousness. And I actually prefer the term awareness, because consciousness, in my understanding, is already all that is. Consciousness does not change, but human awareness is incredibly altered by chemistry, and largely by the chemistry within plants. And so the plants have been working together for millions of years to create all these different aspects, many of them which now we find we have receptors for. And of course, modern scientists are going, well, why do we have receptors? But that's the idea that humans did not arise out of that same very ecosystem. Indeed, the plants have given birth to the humans, so they are our ancestors. And I'd like to remind you all of that. Within that is the idea of using plants, and I invite everyone to redefine their way of communicating their expression of plant interaction, plant-human interaction, with the idea and the concept and the feeling of working with plants, in the sense that those plants and myself are in a team, a balance, in harmony together, that one is not leading, that we are co-creating situations, including rituals. And this is a very important shift that we are here to make together as a community. So with the idea of what is set and setting, basically, in brief, the researchers, the scientists, the people who have discovered LSD and other compounds in the 60s, they were working with these compounds, and they found that there was a missing piece, which was where you consumed the substance and who you were with. And this is incredibly important with all rituals, whether it be a yoga class or where we eat. We all know that these subtle energies are transferred. So we want to explore today the set and setting in designing and developing our own plant rituals where we're harmonizing with plants. Because in my work, what I've realized is that the plants actually lead us. The plants guide us if we're able to get receptive enough. And I do mean all plants, from kale through our salad to peyote and everything in between. There's a sentient consciousness, including the weeds. Right, the backyard plants such as dandelions, they are indeed alive and they are indeed communicating. We just cannot take them to be communicating in English. Right? So we want to explore the difference between three main points of orientation. We have the chakra system, which is incredibly important, and yet this will just simplify it just a little bit. When we have these three points of orientation, it really designs the way that we can explore with plants. These orientation levels enable us to have a certain frame of interacting or listening with everything that we explore. So the most familiar one is the mind. So mental analysis, thinking, digesting thoughts, the doubter, the intellect, the explorer of philosophies. This is one point of orientation. We can easily say the third eye, which is the place of vision, ideas. Okay. Then we have also the heart. This is a place of felt sense. This is a place of feelings and also feeling. This is a place of receptivity, of openness. Also, the downside of that can be sometimes attachment, emotional attachment. So we have these places. The third one we want to pay attention to today is the gut feeling, the instinct, the intuition, the felt perception, the intuitive, instinctual knowing without knowing how we know. And this is a very important faculty to work with when we're dealing with plants, because they are very much intuition-based. And so we want to really focus a little bit on our gut feeling today, really give ourselves the strengthening of that gut feeling. So when we explore this, let's remember to tap into our gut feeling, our gut sense. And of course, what's been found now is that 90% of all serotonin is created in the gut. The bacteria in the gut are present. There's actually a neuronal network. They found actually that there are millions of neurons in the gut as well as in the heart, so that the brain is the only encased neuronal network on the planet, essentially. That roots are a neuronal network. Those are a sensing mechanism. The same with mycelium. Those are a sensing mechanism for the organism. They all help us discern between what is self and not self, and what is my felt senses, and what are the intuitive senses of others. And this is, of course, what we're all exploring, is the ability to feel someone's illness or sickness without, first of all, taking it on as our own, and also knowing when it is ours. And this is a gut sense, a heart sense. So with that, there are many types of ritual, and really, I want to use the term ritual in the most open sense possible. So anything from preparing a meal is a ritual, to making a tea, to making an herbal medicine, to taking an herb or a tea or a tincture every day, to going out and wild harvesting our own herbs for medicine or food, to even cultivating plants and growing plants, and of course all of the deeper works, including creating healing rituals or shadow works or dream works, all of these are rituals. So in my work, what I've done is really tried my best to go towards the earth, to nature, to learn directly. And in that process, I found my intuitive sense through that practice, but in a very careful way. The reason I really appreciate to work with plants is because plants are incredibly honest. Their medicinal properties are always going to be honestly those medicinal properties. So I've often had people say something like, well, if I become an ally with a plant or a mushroom that's poisonous and I ask it really, really nicely, say, pretty, pretty please, if I consume that plant, maybe it won't harm me. There's an assumption there, which is that dying is harming you. And so, yes, some plants will take us into permanent astral projection. And in this way, no plant will kill you. It will take you out of your body. And that plant will do that regardless of how the relationship develops. And that's what I mean by a sense of honesty. So every mushroom, every plant, every tree, everything in nature has a certain vibration of sentience, a certain aspect, a certain function, a certain role in the ecosystem. And they're all very important, and they're all important to honor, and they're all important to respect and to understand the boundaries of each being is very important. So obviously, what we don't want to do is get people to say, oh, well, this plant told me it's medicine, and eat it, and then get sick from it. And that can happen, because sometimes what we do is we superimpose our telling a plant instead of hearing the actual plant itself. So this takes capitulation. This takes careful work and careful balance. And this is really the aspect of foraging or herbalism that is the most intuitive, is that we take our intuitive capacity and then we unite that with our intellectual understanding. And this is the holistic human being. So we're not just using our gut, we're not just using our heart space, we're not just using our mind, but we're seeking to harmonize all of those voices within ourselves to create a harmonious and holistic awareness. So my work has been to go into the forest and to sit with plants and to observe them and to respect them and to know that there's a way of engaging, such as you look and then after you get familiar, you touch very carefully. And once you're familiar, that nothing will occur on your touch, right, such as a rash, etc. Only then do you take next steps. And in that process, one is researching, studying, learning all they can. And yes, learning the Latin names. These are another level in. And don't forget, Latin was once just a magical language like Sanskrit for conjuring, for ritual, for ceremony. So it's important to be very clear with our work, to know when we're superimposing on a plant and when we're actually receiving the guidance of a plant. The great thing is, as some people say at plant walks and mushroom walks that I teach, I'd love to learn about mushrooms, but I just don't want to kill myself. Well, that is a big assumption, that learning about mushrooms means eating mushrooms. The way one can kill themselves learning about mushrooms is by consuming them only. So if you're very careful with not putting anything in your mouth, then you can actually learn for a very long time and be very respectful. It's often said in the Native American traditions that plants are people, right? Plant people, animal people. This is a very important term or idea that we hold in ourselves, because what we can see through that is that I want to respect this being, this individual being, just as I would respect a person. Obviously, if I try to use my friends, they won't really respond extremely well. And the same is true where if I just try to, say, put everyone that I meet in my mouth or try to make out with them, that doesn't really work either. Depends on the community you live in, I guess. So the important thing is to know the boundary of each plant and to honor and respect that. So along with that, we would want to very much open the space. And this is really the first level of all ritual, all ceremony, is what does it mean to open the space? And so within those many levels, we can imagine right now that we're with a plant that we've never seen before, and we're sitting in front of it. And we want to open up the dialogue, the communion, the communication. And so there are many ways we can do this. And one of them is by making an offering. So it's often known that we take, say, tobacco and give some tobacco to the plant because we've learned that from the Native American tradition. And that can be helpful. However, what's most important about giving an offering is that you're saying, I'm willing to learn from you and I will give something for the exchange of knowledge. So I'm trying my best to create a reciprocal energy. I'm not just taking from you. I don't just expect you to give me something. So with that said, it's important to find the balance of drawing from the tradition and using our intuition. So at certain times, anything has resonated, from using your hair, if that's all you have, to even your saliva or your urine, done in respectful ways. Because if you consider even saliva and urine are an exchange of DNA with that plant, and you will forever have an exchange of DNA offered to that plant. So anything from sage to mugwort to tobacco to any of your favorite herbs, including a crystal, including a rock that you've picked up and you've held because you set the intention that you were going to sit with this plant, and you offer that rock to the plant. Some way of engaging the dialogue to open is very important. And by giving that offering, we're seeking to not imbalance the karmic reciprocity of give and receive. So once we do that, we're sitting with the plant, and we can also smudge, and many of you are familiar with smudging. However, I want to just remind everyone that with smudging, again, it's not about using California white sage or using this or that. We want to really find what's naked in ourselves. So, for example, it may be better to work with, say, a local plant like mugwort to harvest and to pray on it and to burn that in our ceremony, because that's the one that we've worked with and we develop relationships over time, versus maybe getting, you know, shipped from somewhere else, Palo Santo, you know, which has maybe deforesting capacities, and we want to be very careful about where these plants are coming from. Just like when we're dealing with food, you know, who prepares our food, who grows our food. The same is true for who prepares and grows and harvests the medicines that we want to work with. So being mindful of that. So once we smudge, it's very important to first clean ourselves, to release all of the stress or the strenuousness that we've picked up, because we are psychic, empathetic beings, and when we work in the world, a lot of static can build up. So when we're smudging ourselves, we're releasing all that. And I recommend to either send that up to the highest light in the center, or down into the earth, which is the core, the lava inside the earth, to take that energy and to transmute it, to turn it into light, to spin it into light. And once we clean the energies, we can offer that smudge to the four directions, or the six directions, or the seven directions, or the 10 directions, whatever work that you feel called to in that moment. You can also call on sacred plants that you work with. You can also call on healing guides, animal totems, ancestors, anything within that situation. But obviously, if you're trying to commune with a plant, don't necessarily call a list of millions of beings into your circle, because it may be very hard then to hear what the plant is saying within all the chatter of all the other forces. So it's very important. As a friend, Kim, asked on the Facebook group, she was wondering how one can actually make smudge bundles. This is very easy to do if you're living on the West Coast. Obviously, there's actually sage, California white sage, which many people are not familiar, is not actually a salvia species, but is an artemisia species. So garden sage, salvia, I do see people trying to make smudges with it. The problem I see with it is that it doesn't dry very well when you just bundle fresh herb together. So that's kind of the issue, is how can you bundle this smudge stick together without getting mold on the inside? One of the easy ways to do that is just, if you bundle it together and wrap it, you can put it in a paper bag in a warm, dry place, and that will help the plant to dry. But you don't have to make a bundle, and you can work with any plant in this way. So depending on the work you're seeking to do, there is a subtle property to every plant. Some of those include sage, cedar, mugwort, yarrow, right? Tansy is also burned. So all of these plants, rosemary, lavender, all of these plants can be worked with, and you can make your own smudge blend. And this is very important, again, as an offering of smoke to clean the energy so that we can be receptive and in a space where we're receiving, not just projecting, right? Again, we don't want to project onto a plant what its purpose is, because then we're taking the same orientation that we've been brought up in, like a scientist going, well, you're good for that, and you're good for that, and you're good for that, and you're good for that. And there are many herbalists who also do that. So they're taking a very intellectual path of, I read in a book that lavender's for this, and I read in a book that sage is good for that. And although this is extremely important, but let us use that as our secondary mechanism. Our primary mechanism is using our intuition to receive. But then instead of then trusting that alone and eating the plant, then we back that up and we verify that with the intellectual understanding. And then we're creating a deep intuitive sense out of that. So the next step is having a prayerful attitude. This is very important, and if we're not able to get into a position, an orientation outside of, okay, I want to learn how to use you so that I can do this, this, and this, or that I can save the world, or that I can be immortal, or that my ego can last longer than everybody else's, all of these things need to be shed in order to really be in a symbiotic relationship. Just like in a relationship, we find, in a partnership, we find that anything that's not seeking to be of service will project back at us. So the same is true with plants. They are great teachers. So with that, we talked about harvesting plants, and I just want to remind you all that since plants are alive, to take all life is equally sacred. And it's very important to get into a state of, yes, the plant does not scream when you cut it audibly, but it may be screaming in a way that cannot be heard, or it may be saying no. And if the plant is saying no, it's best to listen to that and to move on. And again, that's the difference between projecting because we want this, because we found this rare sacred plant and we think it's so cool and we want to show our friends and we want to share it. Any of these motives have to be carefully put to the side so that we can really hear. And this means reading the landscape. So if you find one OSHA plant, out of, you know, hundreds of miles of walking, etc., you might want to wait until that OSHA plant shows you where its whole family is living and that there's enough. And so maybe taking 5 to 10% of a given patch after we've discovered that this is the place that I'm being guided to harvest, and this is the amount, the right amount. So with a plant like mugwort, Artemisia vulgaris, this plant is extremely abundant, so this can be, again, a very easy plant to gather, harvest, work with, and this will create a harmonious relationship by not picking out the few rare, very rare plants, but really working with plants that we have available in our own space, in our own backyard, where we've gotten familiar with the landscape. This is a very important aspect to working with plants in ritual or ceremony. So all life is equally sacred to take, and we must realize that. If we're going to work in relationship, we need to realize that the animal and the plant, all of them have a drive for life in an equal way, just like ourselves. And so since we are taking that plant's life, oftentimes, we want to do it in reverence and honor and respect and understand the consequences. You know, a bunny cannot go to the health food store to get a plant. So whose life are we altering by picking this one leaf out of the forest? It's a very important thing to be aware of. And especially because it's easy to buy all this stuff online and, you know, not really know or care where it's coming from. But that's all part of the ritual, you know. Wherever we purchase something from is the beginning of the ritual, not just when we say, Om, and then we start doing our works. So along with that, another wonderful thing to do as a ritual, as a plant ritual, as an engagement with the ecosystem, with the forest we work with, or an individual plant, is to collect things from that area. And this is either individually or with friends or a community. And to make a kind of mandala of the natural items, the natural things that call to us in the forest. Maybe even taking moments to embody those with certain aspects. Maybe it's the direction, or maybe it's a certain animal. This rock reminds me of my bear totem that I feel resonant with. So I can either blow my intent into this, or I can pray on it. And what I mean by blow my intent, I can actually bring my breath into this object. And then making a symmetrical mandala. And this really holds a very deep energy to create certain ceremonies. So the center of the altar, just like around our crystal. So let's tap into this space again and really see that we are together under this beautiful tree in a sacred forest, and that this is a plane of our awareness that is deeply, deeply helpful. So we come together, and perhaps we all have an object in our hands from nature. And we can all together embody this with some sort of prayerful intent together. And we put this around the crystal, and we all arrange these wonderful natural gifts in a way that makes a geometrical pattern, sacred geometry. And we feel this together, the power of that. This is a really beautiful thing to do together in a circle with friends, especially with children. It's a way to really help people to engage in the sacred in a way that seems harmless enough because it's just art. So, as I mentioned before, another level is doing plant sits and plant meditation. So this may mean that you're recognizing that a certain plant keeps coming to you. Maybe it's mugwort, or maybe it's osha, or maybe it's dandelion. And you keep seeing this. Maybe friends send you articles, or you open up a field guide, or another friend mentions this herb. And so one of the things you can do, if it grows in your area, is you can start to then search for it. And in that process, something deep happens, because as it's known, when you search for something, that same thing begins to search for you. And that's a huge energy that begins to come in our lives and guide us. And so, as you're seeking to harmonize with this plant, again, if you do find it, the first thing you don't want to do is just pick it and eat it, right? You want to actually maybe sit with it and do perhaps weeks or months of sitting with that plant. And so one of the ways we can practice a very simple ritual is we can go into the forest, we can find a plant that resonates with us, either one that we've previously been seeking or just something that catches our attention. And we can actually sit with it, we can bring a notebook, and we can go into a state of receptivity and meditation. And we can allow ourselves to just receive whatever images come, whatever sensations come, and we can ask a series of questions. And most of those questions are more successful when they're based on how does it feel versus how do I feel? Because we can maybe get caught sometimes in, you know, what happened before we got to this moment. But what am I sensing, or how does it feel? These are ways to start pulling guidance, information, wisdom from this specific plant. And so if you write that down just freely, don't think too much about it at that moment. Maybe take 5 to 10 to 20 minutes to really explore that. Then taking that away, right? Once we complete that, we take that away, reading it again, observing, being aware of all that we've received, and just allowing it not to be gospel, but not to be disregarded, just to be in a neutral state about what we're receiving. And obviously, as we practice this after many, many months or many years, the intuition does get honed, the awareness does get trained. And this is a very specific awareness because it's a plant awareness, and not many people are sharing these levels of meditation. So again, I've taken some from tradition, and I've also had to find my way through this because this is sort of a level of plant mysticism. You're developing intuition through working with wild plants. And of course, the reason to not touch is because you may resonate with a plant that has poisonous properties if you touch it. And you could learn a lot from that plant, but it doesn't mean you need to touch it, right, or rub it on you, or put it in your mouth. So these are next levels once we deepen our relationship. So with that kind of journaling and plant journeying, we can also do that with herbs. So maybe it's a tincture you want to work with, or a class of herbs called adaptogens or nervines. These are two plant classes. So perhaps maybe some homework from this council that we're holding here, that everyone might want to take one herb they've always heard about that they wanted to explore, that they know of either being tonic or adaptogenic, you know, from ashwagandha to lemon balm to oregano to rosemary. Just pick one herb and perhaps get enough to where you can make a tea every day from that herb. And without a lot of honey or sweetener or anything like that. We can begin to take a small amount of tea in our meditation. We can just allow ourselves to drink that tea very carefully and slowly, and again asking, how does it feel? What happens? What's happening in my body? What's happening in my mouth? What are the flavors that I explore? And really making this a journaling practice really will teach you much more about a plant than a book can. So I definitely recommend that practice. It's very amazing what you start to pick up on. And it's very intuitive. It's intuition affirming in a very deep and important way, because it brings us into the gut feeling of nature, of ecology. This is a very important field to work in, especially through our activism, through our awareness. And this is very much something that's missing in our modern culture, is the feeling and realization that I am nature, we are nature. So one of the groups of plants, maybe we can call them psychedelic, psychotropic, entheogens, deep plant teachers, the ones that talk really loud, these are the ones that seem to be infiltrating human consciousness at this time to remind us, hey, you are nature. This is nature. This is sacred. You're holy. You're pure. You're whole. Look at this corner. Look at this corner. Look inside of yourself. Look at what's happening on the planet. These plants seem to be ambassadors, messengers to the human consciousness, and they're making themselves known in a deep way. So again, we don't want to use those plants. We want to honor and respect these plants. In the Amazon jungle, those who are drinking ayahuasca, there are sorcerers and there are shamans. The plants are neutral. The respect is the difference between using those plants for our egotistical power and working with these plants to better harmonize our human awareness with nature and ecology and God, or the sacred, or the source, the light. So this is very important, to develop a relationship with all plants equally. So some will yell, some will talk very quietly, but depending on our ritual, our set and setting, our willingness to slow down. For example, has anyone ever sat there like you would with peyote, but use lemon balm, or work with lemon balm? Right? So that way actually enables us to deepen our subtle awareness towards the psychotropic activity of all plants, because every plant is psychedelic. Nature is psychedelic. We're swimming in a sea of consciousness-altering chemicals. Everything we eat, everything we put in our mouth, all teas, all medicine are altering and changing our consciousness. But the question is, can we slow down meditatively enough to ask, what's happening? What is it actually doing? And if we can do that, we can learn so much directly from nature, and it will grow, it will heighten. So with working with these plant teachers on all levels, trying to gain insight and awareness, trying to be a student of the plants and nature, we want to integrate this vision into our daily lives in a big way, which means that it's not just about experiences. We can rack up our experiences and use them as bragging rights for the rest of our incarnate existence. That will not necessarily help and serve anyone else but our egos. So it's very important to learn when to work with a plant and when to not share that story, when to share the story. All these things are incredibly important to understand the orientation of where we're coming from. So we want to really harmonize with, how do we invite this vision, all of the things we're taught, all of the sacred visions, how do we bring these into our lives in a way that brings change within ourselves and within our communities? And of course, what always comes to me is service, right? Service, 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 service. If I can take the lessons that I receive and I can somehow help others, somehow manifest more compassion, manifest more kindness, manifest more awareness and actually be a conduit of the transformation, then this is probably the best way, in my opinion, in my feeling, on how to get others to change. So I just want to invite everyone to be the change that we seek, and this will really help transform others. And working with the plants enables us to say, hey, you know, person with that chronic cough, I just made you some tea. And they might say, oh, that's so nice of you. I'll surely drink your tea. Yet the plant was saying, hey, help me help this person heal this cough. And they may have been resistant if I said, hey, you're coughing really loud, and, you know, this plant's good for that, so here, have this. And just this sometimes subtle service really circumvents a lot of different stress and drama and trauma and all these things that we as healing beings or people with healing intention are trying to bring into our friends and family's lives. So once we do a ceremony, whether it's a healing ritual, whether it's a prayer ceremony, whether it's a plant sit, whether it's a meditation, we always want to complete the space. And of course, we don't want to close the space necessarily, meaning that, okay, now it's time to go on to my life where, you know, I did my spiritual thing and that was deep, and now I go to my life where I re-pick up the old patterns that I was, and I just create a disharmony between those levels. So it's very important that we say thank you in whatever way that resonates to us, to whatever we're sitting with. So we take a moment to breathe in and thank this mandala that we've created together. And in working with the Sphinx Mystery School, we will actually continue meeting under this tree. And we will keep this mandala here with this wonderful crystal in the center. And this way, we will be able to connect on a deep network and to hold this sacred space and this intention for the healing of the planet and all the beings, all the sentient beings within it, to create harmony. So I invite all of you, if you have a meditation practice, if you have a prayer practice, you're always welcome to come to this space where we will hold this space. We will all as a group hold this space together and be together whenever we need, and we will meet together next time we have another council. And we thank all the forces that have come together today to bring this to us. We thank you, plants, in all your forms, in all the ways you enliven, enlighten every cell of our being, from the physical nourishment to the deep spiritual and emotional nourishment you bring. We honor and we thank all of you, plant teachers. We thank the plant allies. We thank you to all the animals, all the spirits and the beings that surround and guide us in council. We thank you so much for being with us. We really ask you to continue to guide us and help us to help others. So I thank you all. If you would like to be in touch, you can definitely see my website, returntonature.us, and Facebook or YouTube as Return to Nature Skills. We'll be putting this up soon on the Sphinx Mystery School and the Return to Nature website. And I open the council to all questions and comments. Thank you all. Aho.
Aho, and thanks. So I'm going to go ahead and enter us into conversation mode. So for everyone who needs to, you can press *6 to put your phone on mute, and then when you're ready to come on and ask a question, you can press *6 again. So I'm going to go ahead and put us in the conversation.
Hey, Dan, this is James Peace. I just want to say thank you, man. I'm about to head out, but I'm glad I got to catch this. Thanks a lot. It was awesome.
Thank you, James.
Everyone have a great day. Peace.
Hello, Dan.
Hello.
Hello. Hi. Sean Simmons. Really appreciated the talk. I thought that was a very wonderful journey and very enlightening. Dan, I had one question for you.
Sure.
When you mentioned that humans were born of plants, or that humans are the descendants of plants, I know that in some sense intuitively, and I know, you know, through the process of evolution, we all have a common ancestor, but can you describe that a little more for me, help me visualize that?
Surely. I love this, to explore this. This is part of my meditations, is to really meditate on the magical mythology we call evolutionary biology. So what we have, very simply, what if you want to engage in the mythology of biology, which I find to have helpful aspects, obviously dinosaurs were eating plants, right? And so that shows that plants were actually here even before the dinosaurs. So really, plants created the foundation of all life on this earth. The reason that we can breathe in oxygen right now was because plants were here on the earth for millions of years producing this sort of situation, this homeostasis on the planet, so that homo sapiens, human beings, could even arise out of the biology of this planet. So somehow that which we call soul has been built biologically to have a home in this ecosystem through all of the different levels of biological levels. So from amoebas and bacteria, built smaller plant life, built plant life, which oxygenated the planet, which enabled mammals, all of this stuff built upon itself to build what we call human consciousness. It's incredibly beautiful and mystifying to realize that in some way the plants knew. So in some way we're the vehicles of bacteria and plants. We're the houses. We're the walking animals that spread them around and talk about them and share them. So they have that sort of awareness. An easy way to really recognize this is understanding. So, you know, if humans disappeared off the planet right now, you know, no other species would really be harmed by it. But if plants disappeared off the planet, the humans would be finished. If bacteria disappeared off the planet, the plants and the humans would be finished. So there is this sort of collaborative experience that's occurred here.
Hi, Dan. This is Emma Kett. I'd love to bring into our circle the plant medicine of ginkgo biloba, because it's a plant that has been on the earth. Its genetics are very similar to prehistoric plants. And the way that the ginkgo leaf grows, almost like out in the sand shape, is a very, very old shape from what I understand. So it's interesting that people often refer ginkgo to be associated with memory because it's such an old genetic plant. And also horsetail, I feel is a very old prehistoric plant as well, and helps us tap into the early dinosaur times. So, and it's bring the spirit of horsetail and ginkgo into this ritual. Thanks.
Amen.
Hello?
Yep.
Hi. Hi. So, my name is Felix Ruth. I friended you earlier today, and I just wanted to thank you so much for your talk. I'm really moved by it, and I really appreciate how grounded your perspectives are and how you're really weaving in, you know, intuitive intelligence with the factual realities of what we know these plants can provide for us. I really want to learn more about how to deepen my ability to dig into what the plants are telling us. So I was wondering if you could recommend books for teachers that I could refer to you so that I can learn more about this connection between plants and ecology and mysticism. I just wanted to ask what teachers have been particularly, influential for you.
Yeah, so, you know, there's basically, let's say there's a few people who are touching this and maybe one who's really touching it deeply. So Paul Stamets, which most of you know, is touching this. If you listen to Paul Stamets, at times he says things like, you know, basically the mushrooms have given him the guidance that he's sharing. So Paul Stamets definitely does it to some degree, but does not teach it as methods, so to speak. Another teacher is John Young, who kind of arose out of what's the tracker school, so the tracker schools in New Jersey. John Young does a lot with bird language, and so some of the aspects can be seen in his work and what he's applied to bird language, I've worked to apply towards plant language in many ways. It's sort of like whispering is either able to be applied to animals, to birds, to plants, you know, all these different levels of receiving impressions and insights. Who else came to mind? There's also a guy, Simon Powell. He talks really fun stuff. Of course, Terence McKenna, right, definitely touches on the Gaian consciousness and engaging with Gaian consciousness, as well as Stephen Harris Buhner. He's really writing some of the really important books on this sort of awareness of how sentient the Gaian consciousness is, as well as ways to tap in, as well as, of course, there's James Lovelock, who has the sort of main points of Gaia theory, so to speak. So these are some people that have written some really helpful and important books. And of course, you know, at all of my classes, even if they seem like very functional classes, like you're learning how to identify black walnuts to eat, there is this deep level of attempt and expression to touch the ecosystem in a deeper way than, hey, where can I get food? You know, where can I get medicine? What can heal me for this? It's always about going deeper into the engagement. So, hope that helps.
Thank you. Yeah, very much.
Hello, Dan.
Hello.
Hi, I had a question. So, the approach that you advise, that you recommend, of coming to plants and you know, appreciating them before, you know, going next steps towards consuming. This is, you know, wonderful to be done on your own personal scale, but what about with the scale of farming, where farmers come to a whole plot of land, and it's not really practical to address every individual plant. What you see in the world of, you know, personal relationship to nature and foraging relate to the world of farming?
Yeah, this is great. I'm really glad you asked, because what we see is that there are individual plants, right? So there's mugwort, for example, as I've brought up many times. And that individual mugwort plant has a sense of self, a self-sentience. So there's times when it's very important to engage the individual mugwort plant. But really, the individual mugwort plant is an ambassador towards the collectivity of mugwort consciousness of all mugwort plants. And so that's on a larger level. We can engage one plant to engage all plants. And once we get to know that being, we can engage the consciousness, the sort of collectivity of mugwort consciousness. On a farming scale, sometimes farmers are incredibly insensitive towards the land they're working with. And therefore, what happens is they monocrop, they deplete the soil, and they cause a lot of lack of biodiversity. Some farmers are using more conscious practices, and so we look at biodynamics, and we look to permaculture as attempts of the methods of harmonizing. And yet there's still a level of sometimes manipulating the ecosystem in order to provide our calories. That said, it's very important to do. That is a very important work. However, like, you know, in any tribe, there are artists, there are painters, there are people who do shamanic work, there are people who do just, hey, man, this is the basic calories. There are many different levels of tribe, of community, of tribe, just like there are with plants. So each plant has a function in the tribe, and just like each person has a function within the tribe. So when we're farming, we want to do the best that we can to make offerings, to give thankfulness, to have thanksgiving, to do the least harm possible, and to not go in there and just till the life out of it and throw what we want and then monocrop it. We see there are many examples where this is not working, and like commercial farming is failing right now because they've killed the soil. And so we need to rebirth more kinds of intuitive processes, and that's where permaculture, biodynamic farming are making those attempts. Are they taking the time necessary to really get to know who's there before they do, you know, their tilling? Not necessarily, but we have to also get our calories, you know, and as we have our calories, develop our relationship to nature, to the wild places, all of these things. Horsetail is actually good for the bones. We learned that about horsetail, right? So horsetail is great for the bones. But of course, horsetail is one of the oldest, most ancient plants on the planet. And so really, it's looking at the bones being the oldest part of the planet, which of course we know our bones are made out of stardust, the minerals. And so those minerals have come from the stars into the earth and congealed, and the plants have absorbed them into their bodies, and we as mammals have grown consuming those plants and building our bodies out of them. So it is really wonderful to start seeing those connections. If we track one mineral from stars to inside of your body, you'll have great meditation.
I had a question when I was, I followed one of your links over to pine needles and making pine needle tea. I was reading about your idea on not boiling it. So many people tell you to boil the heck out of it for 10 minutes to get all the constituents out of it. So I actually tried it last night without boiling it, just bringing it to a high heat just before boiling. Is that what you recommend for all people?
Definitely. Usually for parts of plants that are green, let's say, that's an easy way to describe it, flowering tops of plants, basically anything that's not a root, a mushroom, or a bark, we don't want to boil it. As you can tell with the pine needles, if you boil pine needles, it gets extremely bitter. That's the turpentine, the terpenes coming out of the plant. You're actually extracting terpenes, which is somewhat medicinal, right, but not in large amounts. Yet, if you simmer it, you get this sweeter taste, this less bitter taste. So it often depends on what kind of work you need to do with the plant. Sometimes you need that darker, deeper level, and it will go to darker, deeper levels within ourselves. The lighter flavors generally have more vitamins and minerals, right? So the pine, for example, has vitamin C, but once we track, right? So you track, well, vitamin C is, and these smells in plants are chemicals, and those chemicals, some of them with heat become volatile. We've all walked past a pine tree and smelled that smell. That means chemistry is being released into the atmosphere through some sort of process, through some sort of condition, right? And so that condition is being mimicked in an alchemical vessel called our teapot, right? And so when we add moist, hot situations to plants, they release their compounds just like if you went to a pine forest on a hot day. Some big giant cosmic entity is standing over that teapot and creating rain and humidity. So we always look to the ecosystem to then remodel our situations, and this is where all of these processes, these alchemical processes, originated. So when you simmer pine tea, you will get a much better flavor because you will keep the constituents that would boil off and out into the atmosphere, which could be great if all of your family is coughing and sick and sneezing all over the house. Then if you did simmer that into the atmosphere, you would actually help, like essential oils into the environment, you would actually help reduce the viral count in the oxygen in the air, which is exactly what plants are doing within their own ecosystems.
Well, thank you for that insight, by looking to what the ecosystem is doing and then mimicking it from there. It almost makes me feel like, you know, such a heel to be shifting as far as just buying all of these plants in the form of a tea in the store and like, oh, good, because lavender is good for this and chamomile is good for that, and then actually being thankful, harvesting, and maybe not harvesting because the plant says no. You know, when you look back on how you used to be, or even how you still are in so many ways, it's just, it kind of makes you feel a little guilty.
Well, I hope that we can all, in our transitions, not feel guilty, because it's not like I'm perfect. No one's perfect. We're all learning, and we're all developing this next level of awareness together. This is really the phase we're in, and along with that is transitioning, transitioning, transitioning. Mm-hmm. I still buy herbs. That's great. I wild harvest some herbs. I buy some herbs. So there's always a balance between what is practical and what is essential and what is necessary, and how to continue to create resilient local community to sustain my needs and my desires. I would love to be getting the things local from my own situation more and more, and I feel like through community building, through everything that we're learning to do, especially through online, we are building a better platform for being able to provide ourselves with all this. This is the local cottage economy that we're here to build, which is based on sustainability, sanity, you know, and not mass marketing and all that nonsense. So, you know, no need for guilt, but definitely need for stretching awareness beyond what we were taught. And this is the great blessing that we have.
Thank you, Deb.
Thank you.
I have a question. I don't know if you can hear me.
Yes.
Oh, okay. This is kind of strange. You're probably a vegetarian. I was wondering if there are different animals, I mean, for people that eat meat, do they have different qualities that, you know how plants have different qualities? Animals have different qualities? They, if you eat certain meats, you'll get certain different effects from them.
Yes, this is really a great question, and I am not actually, I don't define myself by any eating choices. I highly recommend that. It's really liberating. We've all put ourselves into these very small categories. If you're this, so you go in that corner, and you're that, and you go in that corner. It's almost like religion to me. I seek a universal harmony, and that really feels like it frees my soul up a lot to listen to my body and to make choices based on what my body is actually telling me instead, again, of what I'm telling my body it should feel. So with that, there is an interesting thing that Kim was bringing up as well about really feeling the properties, you know, really understanding how does it feel. This is a deeper level. So all plants are like totems, right? Each one has their different medicine and their different property. And medicine is not just eating and consuming, it's also harmonizing with. And so sometimes in a plant that when you're not harvesting, even if you're with that plant, you're still receiving medicine from it. And the same is true with animals. And so this brings us into animal totems and realizing that the bald eagle vision right now is related to something within myself. And there is a deep level of medicine being transmitted whenever I receive that sort of vision of an animal in the wild, or you know, even when the house cat decides to jump on my heart and start purring, there is a significance there. With that, then the deeper levels, just like with a plant, is if I'm going to consume this being, if I am going to take the life of this being, how do I honor it in the best way? And one of the best ways to honor any being is through thankfulness, but it's also through paying attention to how I feel. So the number one thing, again, is to just pay attention to how you feel when you receive it. There are medicinal aspects to animals. There are also harmful aspects to animals, like, for example, factory-farmed animals, right? But there also are different levels. I don't know who's decided to shuffle things around, but it's loud. So there are different levels, basically, essentially, with harmonizing with animals.
I think everybody's off mute.
Yeah.
Well, here's another thing, also controversial, in addition to non-vegetarians. How about alcohol and tobacco? Alcohol is derived from plants in general.
Mm-hmm.
Tobacco is a plant.
Yep. So is oil, and so is money.
Right. But, like, for example, tobacco. You smoke tobacco, if you do, and do you get messages from the plant, from the tobacco that you smoke?
Yes. There are different ways to harmonize with different beings. One of, for smoking, which I didn't really talk about, you know, smoking is part of ritual, and depending on whatever plant you smoke, but the thing is, there needs to be a certain non-dependence formed, right? So we don't just want to essentially, what happens is we actually start sucking on a plant. Consider that, like we're actually asking for some nutrients from the plant by sucking on it. And when we do this, what it really seems to be is that we have basically an infantile relationship with that plant. And what we need, what I found helps a lot, is the ability to work with that plant in a more holistic sense. So that might mean growing it, or that might be sitting with it, or that might be just holding it in your hand in a meditation to try to learn the properties. When we expand a more holistic relationship with that being, we need to suck on it less.
Right.
So I think that's really important. Yet, you know, aside from that, the thing is about dosage, right? And so, you know, for example, if you took, you know, if someone took ayahuasca and made it very light and drank it all day, that's sort of an interesting way of relating to it. And so that's what we do with tobacco. However, tobacco is a deeply shamanic plant in basically all lineages. Native American, North American and South American lineage, they say that tobacco was the first plant, right? So the tobacco is everything into the indigenous cultures. Now that said, tobacco smoking in a large amount is once in a ritual is very different than sucking on it all throughout the day to help try to stabilize some sort of stress or strain. So again, it's being aware of what is our intention, what is our set and setting, how do we develop the plant ritual to be of healing, not of dependency or attachment or to appease some sort of thing, or even self-destruction. And we have to look at all of those categories. And so in some ways, the plant is reflecting those things to us. So when we're smoking, it's saying, hey, you know, you're just sucking on me for 20 years. You know, do you want to kind of have a conversation? And maybe we can actually work with that tobacco in a way to allow us to see into ourselves as to why we feel we need this substance in our body. And that's true for every substance we put in our body.
So maybe just growing it and spending time with it would help to alleviate the dependence?
Oh, definitely. Consider, do you use someone for sex, or do you get to know them? You know, and the relationship completely changes when you're willing to see their whole humanness, you know, their shadows, their light, their beauty, their joy, their aspects. So the more you can learn about a specific being, the more you will strengthen and develop a wider relationship. And very much the reason why we sort of all get hooked on tobacco and cannabis and alcohol and things like that is because they're made taboo. So therefore, we have a repression versus a rebellion. So, for example, many less people would smoke cannabis if it was A, legal, and B, you could just grow it freely. There are many countries where that happens, and a lot less people feel the need to smoke it 24 hours a day because of that. So it's like we're reacting to our parents, which is the government.
A rebellion.
And they're making these rules. Yeah, and we're saying, you can't tell me what to do. And so that's our inner child really seeking freedom, seeking to be free. And, of course, we can be free, and we can also engage these beings, but we need to be mindful of if we're creating a bondage within that synthetic freedom, like a pseudo-freedom, that's actually causing us harm. Another aspect to that, which I find, is that tobacco is, like, too strong for me, and I've gone into somewhat of a tobacco trance. And so another aspect that you could practice is trying, when you grow your own and when you work with it, set up a ritual where you knock yourself on your ass with the substance. And that might actually be, it's like ayahuasca. If you drink it every day, you'll think, oh, this is kind of the reaction. But if you smoke enough of it, or if you consume enough of it in a certain way, to where it actually brings you to a deep level of altered state of consciousness, you may also develop a different level of relationship with it.
Well, there are other herbs and plants that can help you get rid of the dependency of that, like mullein, I've heard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mullein.
I don't know what others.
Mullein, you could literally make a roll of joint out of your spice cabinet, and they'd all be better than, you know, cigarettes. So you can make a blend, and you could put a very small amount of tobacco in that. And you could use oregano, rosemary, thyme, coltsfoot, mullein, any tulsi, anything really that's a green leaf, and again, harmonizing with that, trying to see what's going on. So another thing I realized is that, you know, in South America, most of all shamans in Peru use mapacho tobacco as a healing. They blow it all over you. And that's such a different relationship. But they're not sitting there inhaling it. They're actually blowing it out. Right? And so that's another level of relationship of what does it mean to actually engage with this plant being as a healer as it's supposed to be. Tobacco is supposed to be a healing plant, not an addiction plant. Alcohol was extracted as the spirit of the plant, right? So we're really in a different level of engagement because of the prohibited attitude that we've been born into, and we have to be careful that we're not rebelling against mommy and daddy, but actually developing a deeper level of relationship. So, you know, taking tinctures and alcohol for healing is very different than hitting the bottle because I hate my wife, you know, and the setting makes all the difference.
Yeah, that makes sense. Thanks.
Thank you.
Hi, this is Matt here. Just to chime in on that is also interesting. The different uses, like changing forms, and just real quick on the tobacco, and then I also had something else that was coming to mind, but like, for me, like, when I, many, many years ago when I had first started smoking, it was like, the smell of it, it's really interesting because it's like when it's burnt, it has this really kind of dingy, I don't know if that's the right word to describe it, musky smell. But then, like, being able to smell it unburnt, it's a very, it's this wonderful smell, like unburnt tobacco for me. Like, just inhale it and hold my breath and get this certain feeling from it. And then I've also heard people talking about, like, making a drink out of the tobacco in the right quantities to induce vomiting and the purging. So that was a really interesting thing, and I don't know if we'll move on to a different subject, but I also had curiosity about parallel system between humans and plants, and you know, how even the you know, the chakras align with, oh, there's the root chakra. Well, then there's like the leaves, and there's the trunk of our body, and that chest, which is like the chest being a trunk. And you know, how for me, like, I interpret, you know, humans being this kind of mirror to trees, you know, where maybe like smaller animals might be mirrors to bushes, and maybe even smaller animals like mirrors to plants. And I guess just in general, like how there's parallel systems almost on either side of the mirror. So it's not so much a question, but just an intriguing curiosity that I have.
Yeah, this is all really great. To look at those parallels is essentially the meditation, and a lot can be observed there. And it's really beautiful to get the intuition affirmed over and over and over by really being aware of the fact that Gaia innovates systems and recreates them over and over and over and over and over again. So if we observe and we have meditation and contemplation upon nature, the human body is nature's. It's not ours. You know, our culture thinks that the human body is mine. That's ridiculous. The human body arises out of the ecosystem, and every function in the ecosystem is already present. Every function in the body is already present in the ecosystem. So if we can either observe the body and then look at the ecosystem, or look at the ecosystem and observe the body, this is where herbalism originates from. You know, nobody found books initially. There was definitely deep contemplation. This was a huge movement not too long ago, maybe a few hundred years ago. The doctrine of signatures is something everybody can check out. There's also a great diagram about this in the Font Lodge. I think it's, I'm not sure who else is the co-author, but it's called The Yoga of Earth. And there's a beautiful diagram relating the plant system to the bodily system. So that's something that people can check out as well.
Thank you, and it'll be great to listen back to this recording and you know, create links to the various books and resources that have come up in our council today. They're really precious, and we can always continue our work. So, I wanted to speak to in the beginning of your talk around the gut feeling, and I really resonated with that as far as when interacting in our relationship with any of the beings on the planet, but particularly plant beings, that our gut has so much information for us to share. And sometimes certain plants, it feels like I resonate with during certain times of the season or certain times of the moon cycle more than other times. And trusting my gut around what I'm really drawn to right now, and then bridging my heart and my feeling and my mind and knowledge about the plant, like how they can work together and create this bridge of information, this current of information about that plant. So it's interesting, like I went to a Chinese acupressurist and herbalist, and he did a series of muscle testings with various herbs and plants and also some minerals. And it's really interesting how much the body already knows what plants it's resonating with at that time. And I find muscle testing to be an amazing tool in general for learning about the body's wisdom and that gut wisdom. So different ways to muscle test are, if you're by yourself, you can stand up and kind of lean forward and backward and ask your body which way is yes and which way is no, and find that kind of polarity of positive and negative pole in your field. You can also do it with your pointer finger and your thumb placed together and gently kind of pressing your pointer finger and thumb together and pulling those two fingers, pulling them apart and asking which is yes and which is no. and we'll find that our body will naturally keep the magnetic connection between our finger and our thumb, and it's a yes, and it'll loosen when it's a no. So anyway, I love to utilize this technique for when I'm working with plants, if I'm walking in the forest, it's really listening to my body and what it's drawn to, and also, like, at the grocery store, like, instead of making a mental list of, you know, well, I need to get this and this and this, or a heart even going, what do I feel like right now? Like, asking my body and my gut to really show me what it is that my body would like to interact with. So I wanted to just bring awareness into that, into the council today, too, to really tap in with that gut sensation and intuitively. And then, of course, not to limit it to one or another, so the heart and the mind and all the areas of our being and our consciousness have various information for us. But I think sometimes, like for me, I'll start cataloging plans, like, oh, this is for that, this is for this, this is for that. And it's kind of like in dreams when someone says, oh, well, you saw a bird, so that means this. And it's really in our relationship with the plant where the medicine is. So even more than the vision, there's this relationship that's formed with the plant. So I'd love to share also a short story, and then I'll pass the talking stick back. But several years ago, I was working with an organization called Amazon Watch, and basically the intention for the organization is to bring awareness to some of the oil drilling that was happening in the Ecuadorian rainforest in the late 90s and early 2000s. And I had the honor of welcoming many elders and indigenous leaders from the Ecuadorian rainforest to come out to the San Francisco Bay Area to the Chevron Texaco headquarters and to work within the local community there to raise awareness about what was going on. And so we went for a walk in the forest, and I got to bring some of these elders into my home forest where I grew up and loved to walk. And what I found so beautiful about that experience was that the people did not know the names of these various plants that grew in the forest or their Latin name even, but they had an inherent wisdom around what these plants were utilized for. And I didn't even have to really explain. It was there was a interaction and a relationship with the surroundings that that held the lesson. And so one of the elder women pointed to mugwort, which is part of what reminded me of the story today, and says in Spanish, you know, translated, this is for dreams. And she knew that it was a dreaming herb through talking directly with it and feeling comfortable with having that conversation. So I feel like it's a way we can play with our natural surroundings is to have a conversation, and it can feel silly at first, but over time I find that the more we trust that what we're picking up on a gut level is information is true, the more we can continue that conversation. So I will continue this conversation and pass the talking piece. Thank you, Circle.
Yeah, well, thanks, everybody. We definitely really appreciate everything. And it's really fun to have these dialogues after the class. It's really wonderful to hear everybody's thoughts and the flow of where everybody goes with these teachings. So thank you all for that. And please feel free on the Facebook invite event to share your thoughts, your notes, your visions, ideas. All that stuff is really great. I'd love to see it, and I'd love to read it. And feel free again to be in touch at returntonature.us and Facebook, Return to Nature Skills, and lots of classes and articles and videos and all that fun stuff. And huge thanks to Emma for doing this. Thank you so much for holding space for us to share in these wonderful ways.
Thank you so much. sharing with us, and it's a great symbiotic relationship with Sphinx Mystery School and Return to Nature, and we're so grateful to bring these plant teachings. They're very special, and may there be ever more of them on the planet. So part of our intention is to create these records and send them forward into the world to multiply. And so, you know, to all the future listeners who are listening to this recording somewhere in the future and heaven's safe, we thank you too for your presence and for being a part of this transmission. And you know, we're in an oral tradition. We're working with ancient methods of learning in a very new way, this technology. So it's a new evolution of something that we have had a lineage of for a long, long time as humans. So so we really appreciate having Dandelion here, and plant teachings has always been one of our intentions for one of our offerings to our school, as well as dreams and meditation and divination and many other works. So also feel free to check out our website. It's always growing at sphinxmysteryschool.com. And Jessica, it looks like you're back on the line. If you do have anything you'd like to share before we close, we'd love to hear you. To close, we're here underneath this magical oak tree in the mandala. And like Dan said, you know, feel free to visit this space anytime in your meditative practice. And who knows, you might even see someone else in our council there in your vision. but this is a central space for us, and we're gathered around this altar here. And in the beginning, in our opening meditation, we carried a seed from the forest with us. And so this seed, I invite all of us in our imagination to hold it in our hand for a moment. And so we can feel this glowing magic seed in our palm now. And this seed contains the information and the wisdom teachings for us individually and as a collective that we have learned today. And what we are choosing to integrate into our being as we walk forward into our day. And so with this seed, just take a moment to feel it kind of pulsing in your palm. And take a moment without forcing it to just feel inside of your being the messages from this call today, what we've picked up on, and how we're inspired to go forward into our world. And then with your imagination, holding up your seed in your palm to the sun and allowing the sun rays, golden sun rays, to come and bask the seed. And now placing the seed in our palm, on our heart, and allowing our heartbeat to beat its individual rhythm into the seed. So for all of us still here beneath this tree, our hearts are connected with one another. And we can feel an enchainment with each other's hearts as we feel the seed picking up this rhythm. And now, with thanks and total gratitude and love and compassion, place the seed beneath your tongue. And feel the resonance of the seed and your own DNA and the information that serves your highest and best good to retain. Feel it merging with your, and braiding with your own code as the seed rests beneath your tongue. And feeling the information merging. So with this, we give thanks, and we will, once again, we will walk forward into our day with inspiration. And so this circle is complete but never broken. And We wish and intend for healing and protection and guidance for all those that continue on from this circle in the future, now, in the past, and always. So Mary meet, Mary part, and Mary meet again. It is done, I hope.
Thank you all. Many blessings.
Thank you.
Thank you.